Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming to the seminar. I'm going to introduce Dr. Andy Seidl. He's coming to us from the Department of Ag and Resource Economics, acronym DARE, or AREC, as it is in our for like course registration, Ag and Resource Economics. I guess that's where the C comes from here. Economics.
Yeah.
I've had the pleasure of knowing Andy for 4 or 5 years now. When I did my master's in Ag and Resource Economics, he was just returning from a position as the senior economist with IUCN in Geneva, Switzerland. He grew up in Wisconsin, did his PhD in Florida State, right?
Florida, okay.
He then spent some time in Brazil, where at least one of his kids was born, and has worked all over the world since then. He has two kids that are trilingual, at least, I think, one in college at CU. Andy and I got closer when, after I finished my master's degree, IUCN contacted him for a project in the South Pacific doing ecosystem service valuation. And Andy said, I can't really move to the South Pacific, but I know a guy who might. So he sent me and backed me up, and we worked together on that project. And during that couple year project, some other opportunities came around, and one of them was this biodiversity finance project. So Andy became involved with that, that he'll talk about today, and which isn't just in the Pacific, but all over the world. I think he brings a unique perspective to the university, not just to his department, and his ability to work internationally and have this consulting experience while being a full tenure professor and teaching a full load. He's loved by students if anyone's ever taken his class. So it's pretty cool you can balance those two things. So thanks for coming.
Thanks, Jake. That was awfully kind, Jake. I've given up sleeping, actually. It's been really not. It's really overrated, mostly. So this is a little different. It's not a research seminar so much as it is application of what you do with applied research, right? What do countries do with the information that we try to provide them, and what do we do when our work actually gets used, right? So it's a pleasure to be here and talk to you guys. So Mind the Gap, Quantifying the and Bridging Biodiversity Finance Gap. This is a UN project, so it's lots of alphabet soup. Is everybody familiar with these? If I say these things, will you give me a dog look, or will you go, uh-huh, yeah? The CBD COP, yeah, 11, 12, and 13. See, now, if we were on climate change COP, right, it'd be different numbers. Okay. Top one, National Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan. Each country has one to support their contributions to the Convention on Biological Diversity's Aichi targets. Okay? Yeah.
Countries that didn't sign that, do they?
No.
Okay.
No. 171, I think, signatories to the CBD? Yeah. Is that wrong?
193.
Lots. Okay. Against the Aichi targets, there are 20 targets in the CBD strategic plan. The 20th one is about resource mobilization, which is shorthand for bringing in money. It's at the university, too. They call it development, right? Oh, I work in development. Oh, no, you don't. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about this. I'll start out with sort of what's the problem, you know, making the business case, if you will, for biodiversity finance, not for biodiversity because of where I am. You guys get that part. But the finance part, you might not. So we'll talk about that a little bit, and then how BioFin steps into that void, and then some of the early results we've had in BioFin, Biodiversity Finance Initiative. This is another one you might not know, STA's Senior Technical Advisor. There are four of us on this project under the UNDP. If you like flags, these are the 30 countries that are currently in the BioFin, and here are the donors, which you must have always. Okay, the donors are the EU, Germany, Norway, Flanders, that one's different, and Switzerland. So in UN speak, we have What is the Biodiversity Finance Initiative? A global collaborative partnership to develop and implement an evidence-based methodology that improves biodiversity outcomes using finance and economics. No colons, but two breaths. So what is this really saying? That we're going to work under the Sustainable Development Agenda of the United Nations and wed issues of biodiversity management, conservation, with issues of economics and finance. Okay? Who has heard of this initiative? Okay. Fair enough. Little context then. Because we're going to be talking about numbers that have like 12 zeros after them, it's hard to get a handle on what it is we're really dealing with. So let's start with the Sustainable Development Agenda and then get into biodiversity, if that's okay. So cumulative gross domestic product of all countries in the United States, including the United States, was $73 trillion in 2015. Anybody know what U.S. was? No? About 18. How about Canada? About one. So that gives you some perspective. China, what is China? 11? Yeah, China's 11 trillion. So it gives you some ideas. That's all the economic activity that is being counted in the world. That's not all value, that's not all activity, it's all that's being counted using money. Okay? Intergovernmental Committee on Experts of Sustainable Development Finance had a meeting back in Addis Ababa last year, thus the Addis Ababa Agreement, AAA, where they decided that in order to fund the Sustainable Development Goals, we needed a total investment of 3.3 to 4.5 trillion. That's to support them in developing countries. Now, the SDGs are actually supposed to be for all countries, so already we're off on a wrong foot. But for developing countries, that big number, that's got 12 zeros behind it, and against a gap of 1.9 to 3.1 million, trillion, sorry. So that means we've got approximately 1.4 trillion committed, right? So if 1.4 trillion is committed, out of 73 trillion, that's about 2% of global GDP that's committed, more or less, yeah? Just so we have an idea. So that's where we are to start with. Now let's move on to the benefits side of biodiversity. The valuation studies that have been done, what do they say? Well, they say that natural capital in the world, Costanza in 2014, but also famously in 1997, indicates that we're at around 125 trillion, just as a big old ballpark number for the value of natural capital in the world. For those things that are not, that are renewable resources, so fish and trees and the like, somewhere more around 24 trillion, according to the World Bank. Doesn't deal with things like outdoor recreation or non-consumptive uses that are actually quite important, or lots and lots of values that you might have. They're not in there. And then the third one we have is, what would happen if we didn't have it? What's our risk of destroying natural capital? Well, it's around, for the productive and processes of primary production, so making things like chairs and stuff, $7.3 trillion per year. So these are big numbers. They're on the same order of magnitude as the global GDP, more or less, right? So they're saying that natural capital is extremely valuable. We all in this room know that. But what we don't know is what the return on our investment might be, because we don't know really how much we're investing. So the biodiversity finance part is to deal with how much is it going to cost, how much do we need to invest, and in fact we're trying to change that dialogue from a cost center to an investment. That is, we're investing in the future of the planet, we're not necessarily consuming through a cost center. What's that return? That's what we're hoping to get after. So identifying what the biodiversity finance gap then is something that the CBD tried to do, Convention on Biological Diversity tried to do back in COP 10 in Nagoya, at COP 10, the Convention Conference of Parties, COP 10 in Nagoya. They said, okay, the The signatory countries would like to have more money from the donor countries, and the donor countries say, well, how much are you currently spending? And how much do you need? And most developing countries, in fact, no developing country could actually say how much they're spending and how much they need. This is the problem. They say, well, this is a valuable thing. We need, and IUCN, when I was working for them, came in saying, we need to increase biodiversity investments by, some people were saying tenfold, some were saying 40-fold. I said, well, let's go for 100 because we don't know what X is. We don't really know what we're multiplying by. That's a problem. So the CBD got together a high-level expert panel to do a top-down sort of an estimate of what they thought was being spent and what was going to be needed specifically for funding the signatory countries, and you're right, it is 193, MBSAPs, the National Biodiversity Strategies and Action Plans. Okay? So that expert panel got together and they looked at all the information that they thought they would be relevant, and they came up with a biodiversity finance gap of somewhere between 150 and 440 billion. So we've lopped off three zeros. Okay, so we're looking at more of a, we're looking at a 1,000-to-1 sort of return on investment, just in ballpark figures. Or 0.08 to 0.25 of global GDP that would need to be invested in order to fulfill all of the MBSAPs worldwide. Now, recall that development aid is supposed to be approximately 0.7% of GDP of every developed country. No, this is global GDP, we're dividing by different numbers, but global GDP 0.08 to 0.25. For development aid, most all countries are supposed to be contributing 0.7% or more. They don't, but that's what they're supposed to do. The number on Sustainable Development Goals, again, was about 2% of global GDP. There's some other estimates out there. They're going to be. This is not a precise science. This is an eye-opener, an awareness-raising sort of a number. Top-down numbers are going to be that way. All biodiversity investments and biodiversity strategies and action plans are done at the national level. So what we need is national-level information to be aggregated, not global information to be trickled down. Thus, BioFin steps in. At COP11, the CBD said, hey, we need an initiative to pilot a methodology to estimate the cost or the investment required to fund these national biodiversity strategies and action plans. We need you to help us to understand how to operationalize Target 20 of the strategic plan. So that's what happened. COP11. What's biodiversity revenue look like? I maybe should have quizzed you before I actually put this up. What are the primary sources of biodiversity investment worldwide? This is a Global Canopy program. They do some great work. I bet you might have thought a lot of it was here. Over official development assistance, aid. Might not have thought about this one, domestic budgets. But the lion's share of biodiversity investments are going to be from their own country, in developing countries. Green subsidies, so not fossil fuel subsidies, for example, right? Philanthropy, 1.7. Green products, so forest-certified products or shade-grown coffees and things like this. Rainforest Alliance stuff, 6.6. Summing up to an average of about $52 billion per year. So we've got $52 billion currently being spent, between $150 and $440 billion needed against a total benefit that is 1,000 times that. These are the get your foot in the door numbers. Graphically, or what do we call these now? Infographics? Yes. Infographically, it looks like this. $52 billion, what we're currently spending, $150 to $440 billion, what we need, and this is the value. So BioFin is in the business of figuring out this gap here. One way to help help understand what that gap is to use this leverage. Say, this is what we get when we invest. This is what it's going to cost for us to invest. So we combine finance, policy, and economics to facilitate sustainable biodiversity management. And I should have put up the disclaimer about the pictures. So, since I'm an economist, and I don't think about such things, you may have, for example, Philippines results against a polar bear picture. I just don't think that way. And so, don't tell me that species does not occur in that. I know that, okay? So what's biodiversity finance? That's the first thing we got to get around. It is an investment. It is not only public sector. This is the big difference between what mostly gets done at the country level. Mostly they've done biodiversity or they've done climate expenditure reviews or other expenditure reviews. Those are about public sector only. Right, so they're trying to figure out what the public expenditures are. What we're trying to get after is all expenditures. So it's public and private because of the fact that the world is about 80% private sector and about 20% public sector, and if we ignore the private sector, we're really not going to get very far very fast. Now, that said, getting those data is a challenge because they don't have to give it to you. So, private and public financial resources, and we're talking about intention here. It's very difficult. There's no budget line for biodiversity, right? So we have to go through all the budget lines, all the codes, and figure out what was spent on biodiversity. Some of them are easy. You know, protected areas, pretty easy. But some of them are not easy, agriculture. So what we need to do is not, what we've decided to do is code those budget lines based on intent. Is it 100% intended to affect biodiversity positively? Okay, and for the direct expenditures, we count those all 100%, and then there are these things, indirect expenditures, and we come up with a way to weight those, particularly like ag policy, 25, 50, 70, depending on the country and how they feel their policies are actually affecting biodiversity. And that, by summing the 100% of the directs and say the 25, 50, and 70% of the indirects, we get a total for public. And then we add in the private sector, and we are quite careful, and civil society, and have to be a bit careful about double counting. Right? So if World Bank gives money to Conservation International, who implements projects, we don't want to count the same money twice. Right? So we use some techniques, some budgeting techniques, to get at implementer or at, you know, at the various scales of where the money might be counted. So I told you, launched in 2012, I think, under initial grant from the EU. I told you about the sponsors, donors. There was no methodology for this per se. There are methodologies for accounting. There are methodologies for expenditure reviews. There are methodologies for a variety of things, but not one for biodiversity. So we use what's out there. We use what countries are currently doing, adapted the methodology to this particular situation. And then we use as leverage their additional work that they're doing on climate and on the system of environmental economic accounts, SEA, or for the reporting requirements to the CBD. So we're trying to not make more work, but maybe put an additional column in their budget. We work with, perhaps uniquely among conservation work, we typically have the lead be the Minister of Finance, and secondary be Minister of Environment, and tertiary Minister of Planning. And so we bring those three groups together because typically when you do an environmental project and you only work with Minister of Environment, you don't get very far. So having Minister of Finance on board saying, yeah, this is an accounting approach that which we understand, then we get a little bit further. This was last presented, the most recent version, which I was gonna bring the book over, but I forgot. Just in December, and so we're working with a 2016 version currently. We should finish the first phase of this project about a year from now. There is, as always in the UN, anticipation of second phase. You always have to think of the second phase. At country levels, you're supposed to think about how you're going to leave it, but at the UN level, you're supposed to think about how you're going to continue, right? Okay, so what do? We support the CBD strategic plan. Responding directly to Target 20 on resource mobilization in support of the other 19 targets. and in the delivery of the MBSAPs. Here's our evolution. A little thought, then we kind of went to, okay, we're going to do these four different types of approaches in sequence: policy and institutional review, costing your NBSAP, resource mobilization strategy, and then launch your resource mobilization strategy. Found out that that wasn't working real well because we got hung up here and didn't pay much attention up here. And say, what is the policy context? What is the enabling environment? What can we do legally in this country in order to facilitate investments in biodiversity? That wasn't getting done, and then when we got here, we had a lot of trouble with actually executing. So we developed further into this outer ring, the ring, into biodiversity finance policy and institutional review is the first output, but not outcome, of course. Biodiversity expenditure review, then a needs assessment. So how much are we spending, then how much do we need? The difference between those two things is the gap. So mind the gap. Then the financial plan, and then implementation and institutionalization of the finance plan. That is, you don't want it to be a report on the wall, but actually implementation. So we set aside half of the budget for implementation, and they don't get it until they get here. Okay? And then there are a bunch of other things that we're working on, working toward 2018 in the phase two, better integration of learning tools, e-modules and such, but also against other sustainable development initiatives that the UN that are currently ongoing. So natural capital counting, environmental economic accounts that all countries should be reporting against, working on return on investment, those sorts of things, scenario analyses, and a number of more, you know, extensions. Questions so far? No. Okay. This is what it looks like then, graphically. Everything ending up in the plan. Right now, we only have two countries that are at the plan stage, and we have most of them are kind of in here right now. Conceptually, this is what we're trying to do. Identify what the current level of finance is, what's being spent. Then, and doing that through their accounting framework. Then figuring out what is needed in their MBSAP, and that typically they don't know that. And so we work with them to try to figure out what they need through through their MBSAP, which hopefully is at the level of either outcomes or really good activities. Okay? Then we extrapolate those results into the 2020, or in some countries 2030, into the future, their planning horizon, in order to understand what they will need in the future. But in the meantime, we try to identify some areas where we can improve performance as well. So I was just in Indonesia last week, and we're looking at their BER, their Biodiversity Expenditure Review, and how to send it that direction. And several of the people said, well, we're really corrupt and we're really inefficient in our implementation. So we think that we could deliver better biodiversity outcomes. We think we could reduce the amount of expenditures that are needed to get these things done, but we don't know by how much. So we looked at some existing studies that said, well, the effect of corruption on public policy implementation in Indonesia is about 60% of the budget goes in somewhere else. 60. Yeah. So I said, well, that's a good ballpark number to use. A little high. I was thinking 15. Yeah, no, 60. Okay, good. So there's some cost savings if we can cure that one. But what they want to do, like everybody wants to do, because they see a pot of money, is they want to do a pilot study to figure out how efficient they can be. They're like, well, is there any existing information out there that we could use? So we're trying to work with that. So realign expenditures toward our priorities. Often we don't know what the priorities are. Avoid future expenditures, that is, don't put bad policies after, or good policies after bad. Get rid of the bad ones. Deliver better. And then also generate revenues from different sources. So we're looking at things like, we have a catalog of 100 different mechanisms, including green bonds and variety of things that would kind of come into this area here. And so then we end up at an estimate of what it is they think they need and what and where they're going to get it from. Similar idea on the four sort of areas that we try to work at. So we want to reduce pressure on biodiversity, and we want to improve biodiversity outcomes. And we can do that by enabling actions or by financial flows or investments. Typical timeline is about 2 years for this. Some are taking longer, some are quicker. Kazakhstan was super quick. Shocking, I think. Brazil, who I spoke with this morning, not so fast. So they're working on it. I guess back to this one. Too often these development projects start with communications and implementation up here after they finished off all the technical work. We're trying very hard to integrate communication strategies and stakeholder involvement and engagement from the get-go, such that when we get to the end, we have a plan that's well bought in and ready to go. You see too many times where you think you've got the plan and you find out you went down the wrong path, right? So hopefully if everybody's on board all the way along, now that's easier in Belize, it's harder in Indonesia, you know, big countries, but we do it to the extent that we can. So what are we trying to do overall? Design a process that is country-driven, that is not top-down, it's from the country itself, to help them figure out what to do and to provide support and an analytical framework for them to undertake this, this approach. There are four, as I said, four STAs, four senior technical advisors. I support five countries, Malaysia, Indonesia, Belize, Brazil and Fiji, and the other three, one's based in Philippines, one's based in Paris, one's based in DC, and they cover the other 25 countries. Mine was done on the approach to try to minimize the carbon footprint of my flights. So here's our map, here's where we are. Came on in several cohorts, so most of Latin America came in the first cohort, but Cuba and Brazil came in just recently, for example. We've got a good selection of the most mega biodiverse countries in the world, which is good. We've also got some unique ones that people like to hear about. Bhutan, for example. Everybody wants to go to Bhutan. You can see also some gaps, some places where we don't have investment. There's a big one. West Africa. Recall that this was intended as a pilot. They want pilots to succeed. It's really hard to do work in West Africa, I mean, just in general. So it was a strategic decision not to do that to start with, but to get some good track record and get the methodology working. And then phase two, we'll have more focus here. Perhaps the rest of the Caribbean, which you can't really see, but places where we, more SIDS, things like this, where we don't have as much representation. Like Fiji's the only country in Oceania, for example. We try to leverage our work with other work, particularly UN work around the same area. So WAVES, who's heard of WAVES? Okay, yeah, I would imagine Kelly. Wealth Accounting and Valuation of Ecosystem Services. It's a World Bank project that is working on national accounting through SEA, through that accounting framework. And they are substantially smaller than we are. They've got 10 countries right now, only had 6 just a few years ago, and we try to overlap with them as much as we can. They're smaller, but they have more money, so it's World Bank. That's how it works. To some results. Policy and institutional review sets the stage, helps us understand what's possible within the current policy environment. We look at budget cycles, we look at the legal frameworks, we look at governance, and or let the we let the country do that. I don't do that. They do it, and they identify places, gaps in their legal framework, or places where things are at cross purposes, potentially perverse subsidies. You know, if we're subsidizing fossil fuels, or for example, or overcapitalization of fisheries, or forest concessions that are underpriced, those sorts of things, that would show up in the PIR. Early results include these two, where Indonesia decided to revisit its environmental law, its primary environmental law, which had not been in, revisited in 32 years, which meant that it needed to include the Rio Conventions. It needed to understand what was going on since Rio. Right, and to integrate into their legal framework potential for things like biodiversity, ecosystem services, these words that we all use so frequently now, not found here. Similarly, and so it's hard to then assign damages if you don't have a word for it. Just simple, kind of simple things like this. Similarly, Peru last year, 2015, came through with a new policy that explicitly discusses what an investment in biodiversity is, and what an investment in ecosystem services is. And then you have some leverage if there is either something positive or negative going on, if you have good legal framework. Question? Looked like you had a question. No, just nodding. OK. So that's to the PIR. Supporting the MBSAPs in most countries, but in particular in these, Colombia, Fiji, Indonesia, Seychelles, South Africa, and Sri Lanka. One of our partners resigned this morning in Sri Lanka. I mean, sorry, in South Africa. Not good. The Minister of Finance resigned this morning. We'll see what happens. We've had this happens, right? This happens in these projects. Belize has had a couple of hiccups along the way, for example. In Malaysia, they don't use the MBSAP. They have their National Development Plan. The 11th plan was for 2016 to 2020, and then they're going to go 2021 to 2025 for their 12th plan. And that in those plans, they fully or now are fully integrating investments in biodiversity, natural capital, management of the resource base toward economic development goals. This is an example of a result from the Biodiversity Expenditure Review that was done for Namibia. Namibia uses the our methodology, the BioFin methodology, but is funded by GIZ, so separately, the German Development Agency. So this illustrates where all the money comes from, up to the point where they have budget information, and you could do either budget or expenditure or both. They're not the same number. This one's through 2012. And then they know what's coming on the budget cycle, because you don't actually, you know 2 or 3 years ahead of time what's coming. So that's this green dotted line. And then from there onward, they don't know. And so what we do is we have a most likely scenario, a pessimistic and an optimistic. And these vary by country, but they can be 5, 10, 15% around that, what they think it's going to be. It's an interesting, useful exercise for them to go through to see kind of, you know, like a sensitivity analysis. Does it matter? If we have a bad 10 years, what's going to happen? And so this is useful to them. This one is in nominal dollars, or nominal, yeah, Namibian dollars, right? Yeah. And it always shows, when you do it in nominal terms, that is, you don't correct for inflation, it is always going up. Countries love to give these. Oh yeah, we're going to spend more and more and more, mo. But if you correct it for inflation, whoops. So we go up, and then, our projections are really just to cover inflation. We tend to recommend that they use both. They tend to like to put up the nominal numbers, not the corrected numbers, but the corrected ones are really the ones that you can compare year to year, right? In fact, you cannot compare nominal numbers across 2 years, technically, but everybody does it. And this one's broken out by the various agencies of the government that have biodiversity expenditures within their responsibilities and within their budget. So we'll go in the BER, we'll go through the, it's not exactly low-hanging fruit, but we'll go through the primary sectors or agencies that will be spending money. So we'll go through parks and tourism, we'll go through ag, fisheries, forestry, the places where we know there's going to be biodiversity expenditures. Sometimes we get into infrastructure and some other things, but we don't typically do the entire budget. It's really too much of an investment, really, for marginal return of something small. So we try to get about the 80% solution, if you can. So that's what they've done there in Namibia. This is Fiji, where we decided to use a technique called a weighted moving average in order to do our extrapolations because they had a year of high inflation. And if you had done a direct extrapolation of your results, you would have gone up into the sky, which was probably not going to be accurate. So what we did here is took, I think it was a 3-year moving average and a 5-year moving average, where the most recent year gets a heavier weight than the past years in order to predict what's going to go into the future. That tends to reduce the amount of variation. This one is organized around its 7 areas in their MBSAP. 7, right? Yeah. So how much is going to go to forest and agricultural management? How much is going to go to invasive species management and so forth? So this one's tagged differently. You can tag it by agency, by implementing partner, or by MBSAP category, for example. Talked about the direct and indirect expenditures. This was India's approach to try to understand intentionality about biodiversity expenditures. They said, okay, for our direct expenditures, they would be, they look like this, right? So what is it? What's an example of it? And how much do we attribute that expenditure to biodiversity? And what they did is sensitivity analysis around that assumption. So it, with direct expenditures, they're 100, 100, 100. With some others, they may vary the percentages and see what happens, see how much it affects your results, just like a sensitivity analysis you would normally do, particularly when you've got such things that are difficult, but when you've got an economy the size of India, 1% difference is a lot of money. So you can't really just wish it away and say, well, it's just 1%. It's $1 million or it's $10 million. It's a lot. So indirect, medium indirect, and low indirect, and then assigning values according to this. This is typically done in some sort of a stakeholder process where they agree on what those percentages might be and what the range should be. Now, this is clearly policy science, not hard science, right? I'm just trying to figure out appropriate ranges. This is how Kazakhstan does it. For, it was water investments, I believe, primarily, right? For direct to indirect and how they attribute those percentages. When we move to the financial needs assessment, the key is to try to prioritize, projects or programs that will get attention. And so we try to help countries through this prioritization process where often they wouldn't have one. And they just say, well, we need to fund the MBSAP. You know, okay, but what if we don't have enough money? Then what do we do? So we tried, this works fairly well, where you've got the costs of the cost of getting your result, whatever the biodiversity result is, if you've got it down to outcome as opposed to a project, that's better. And then the priority of the results go from lower to higher. And so we can identify then the higher priority things based on essentially return to investment. Low investment cost, high return, good, right? High cost, low return, bad. So that's how the priorities work. So when they go through that prioritization process, then they will look at various ways to address that priority. So this is South Africa. They've got 30% decrease in poaching incidents of white rhino. Very specific outcome, right, that they're looking for. four different ways to do it. What the short-term impact is, recognizing that politicians have short-term time horizons. And then long, short for the longer term, you know, is it only a short-term project or is it potentially a long-term one? What is its cost? And then to prioritize, we choose among the cost-effective, most cost-effective process or project, because we don't typically have the benefit side of the equation. We only have the cost. So we said, this is a good thing. It's a high priority. Now, how do we get at that high priority for the least cost? That's what this process is supposed to do. This is the Philippines, where they've gone to estimating their gap analysis. They've figured out what their cost of implementation is, and then the next slide will be their gap analysis. So this is also organized around their MBSAP, around the various categories of effort that they have. Their categories do not line up with the CBD directly, and so we've got a bridge that helps us to categorize these toward the CBD so they can report to the CBD appropriately as well. Theirs goes up steeply because they want to establish a protected area network, and that will take some startup costs, and then they think it's just going to be an operational cost after that, and so it comes back down again. See, it's the green under protected areas, goes up, 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 and then it drops. It's not that they're going to disinvest from protected areas, it's their, it's a startup cost issue. So here's their gap then. This is what they think it's going to cost them, and here's their gap for the various, for the total, they call it a PBSAP, Philippines Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan. Indonesia does the same thing, IBSAP, where they estimate their total costs, and then their gap estimate is done under various types of scenarios based on their assumptions about what the world is going to bring them over the next couple of years. They went through 2030 as well. And I tend to recommend that if you're going to go through all this process to put it out far enough that you can actually make a difference. This one's for Ecuador, where they did a gap analysis by MBSAP result and graphically gave you a little bit different information. So the blue, dark blue, is the baseline scenario, and then the orange is the gap analysis. And so as you would normally want to do with a benefit cost analysis is to do with without, not before and after, right? So you make sure you have a baseline scenario and then the projected scenario that you think you're going to have. And these are their 19 results. For the finance plan, biodiversity finance plan, this is the general approach to it. Basically, you use all the information that you gained through the other three outputs. You got priorities, you know how much you need, and then you try to identify those mechanisms or solutions that are feasible and of high priority for you, for that country, and then try to pilot a couple of them, two, three, four, in the next time period to try to demonstrate that that some things are possible. So in going through that process, they start with a rapid screening of potential techniques or tools, some 50 to 200 of them, and gradually narrow them down to something that's workable, and then do some technical analyses of those 15 to 20, and then choose four or five to actually try to implement. The bit up in the upper right is the types of, you can't read it, of course, and I can't either, the types of approaches that are possible, regulating or taxes or subsidies or things like this. And that's what I've got for today. I hope we've still got some time for some questions. The project, as I said, is intended to go through 2018. And hopefully we're going to do some good. Thanks.
Yes.
So how many countries are you going to be able to work with through the 2018?
We're working with those 30 pilot countries, and then just this year we've launched regional nodes, so countries that aren't being supported by UNDP on this $30 million, but are interested in the methodology can sign up on their own money or on money that they've gotten from other places to start the biofin process. We've got a node, regional node in Istanbul, one in Panama, and one in Thailand. And right now, the one in Africa is more, it's been, or the one in Istanbul, which covers Africa and South Asia, sorry, South, yes, Southwest Asia, has had some folks signing up and are interested in going, so like Comoros and Nigeria, which was an interesting one. We're not sure what to do about that one, actually. but yeah, so we've got a regional, one person at each of the regional hubs that participates in the global team, and then we support the regional hub person, and then if they need us to go and help those countries, we try to as we can, but we don't have funding for them currently. So this will be opened up to all 140 countries that are whose NBSAPs are supported by the UNDP or UNEP.
So earlier you said that you look at intent to try to understand the percentage of like an agricultural budget that you might support biodiversity. So how do you understand intent?
We ask.
You do interviews.
Yeah, well, they just determine intent themselves. So, what was the point of this policy? Yeah, we support. I'm not implementing five biofin projects. I'm supporting five biofin projects.
So, what does it look like then for them to implement them? I mean, what is the process?
It really varies quite a bit by country. The smaller countries that have a really active environmental lobby and NBSAP kind of process, like Fiji, for example, it's a small group of people. So they bring in the folks, they talk it out, and they kind of move together through that NBSAP. And it tends to work in that country through the reporting of the NBSAP. In, say, Brazil, it will not work that way. They don't put a lot of store in the NBSAP. And so the reporting requirements against the NBSAP, they don't care that much about. They're more worried about planning at the national level. So we're working with IPEA, which is the policy research arm of the central government, to help them to basically go through all the budgets and figure it out. So it's less of a stakeholder-driven project process there. Indonesia's somewhere in between with some turf issues, like the BAPENAS, which is their planning agency. It owns the NBSAP process, but finance holds the budget, and so they have to talk. And that sometimes they have silo issues sometimes. Yeah.
I'm curious if your work and your partnership is connected somehow with the International Panel for Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services.
IPBES. IPBES, yeah. Intergovernmental Panel. Yeah. Yeah. At the last COP, it was recommended that IPBES reach out to us. So that means no, not yet. But yeah, it's supposed to happen. There is this funny sort of relationship between IPBES and policy people that they don't seem to like each other that much. At least the ones that I've been interacting with. Well, not like, it's more like they don't pay attention to each other very much, I think. So all the fact gathering and all the, you know, all that synthesis work that IPBES has been doing, it doesn't seem to reach the government folks. And the stuff the government's doing over on this side, they don't interact with the IPBES. It's something that needs to change, clearly. Who's up? Go ahead.
Thanks, Andy. It's great to see a global scale view of what's happening. So it seems like when we hear about outcomes from the CBD, the news is never good. And so to put it lightly, right? I mean, you know, 2010, no countries were reaching their goals.
Right.
And then the latest stuff I've seen on the Aichi targets, like there's like 55 indicators for these 20 targets, and 46 of them are projected to not be met.
Right.
And so what I'm curious about in the analysis you guys are doing is the degree to which we can, you know, figure out what's going wrong. You know, so like how much of it is bad policy, you know, the policies don't match the problem, how much of it is an implementation thing, like the corruption, or how much of it is just more money, you know? I mean, so can you differentiate those things at all?
Yeah, our first frustration has always been in digging into the MBSAP itself, because they tend to be, they can be political pronouncements and not really project, or they're not outcome-oriented documents. So they don't get to, this is the change we want to see, and this is the project that I'm going to do to get that change, and then this is what, you know, and that's the money I need and the expertise I need in order to do that. They might say, we're going to, you know, we want to start a protected areas network. Okay, like what? Like whose? Or, you know, give us something. You know, how many? What? How many acres? Protecting what? Nothing. And so most of the MBSAPs are kind of like that. And so it's hard to work with a planning document that really doesn't have any teeth, I think. And then there is a funding gap, clearly. There is corruption and there is inefficiency and there's a lack of capacity in lots of countries to actually do the implementation. So there's lots of stuff going on. And so pointing
all
at, all of the above. So pointing at one, and well, the reporting frameworks are not very good either. So actually, you know, CBD's reporting framework is kind of rough. So it's really, there's a lot of challenges all around. They may actually be making progress and wouldn't have a way to report it. So, but being the eternal optimist, let's go beat up on it some more and see if we can't fix it. Well, what do you think?
I mean, I'm not surprised at all of the above, you know, I mean, it makes, I'm curious as to the degree to which it's money versus policy, you know, and it sounds like to me, to be honest, with the data, right?
Right.
I'm sure that,
yeah.
Because the funding frameworks aren't both.
Yeah, there's a lot of, even in our government, there's the budget meets the need, right? How much do you need? How much do you have? And that doesn't help with efficiency and things like that. Yeah.
And sometimes money can create more problems than it solves, right?
All right.
By
creating
centralized policies that don't fit.
Yeah, I wonder if climate will provide us a nice case to look at with all the money being thrown at it. You know, will it actually change outcomes, or will we have more corruption, or what? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'd be interesting. Kelly.
Yeah, and so, well, if we think money's part of the problem, I guess, are you guys providing suggestions or recommendations on how they would close the gap? And you mentioned the private sector in the beginning, so I'm wondering if you could talk about what are some of the visions of how they would help close the gap?
Yeah, so we are, when they get to the finance plan, that's where we start looking at all the different mechanisms that are possible and, you know, try to get them away from simply ODA and asking for more money. And so it's domestic budgets, but it's also ODA, and then it's, yeah, is there private sector investment that's possible here? And everybody wants a PES these days, which I'm sure you'll be happy to hear.
Not really working yet, so far.
Well, there's that. Green bonds, impact investing, crowdfunding people are awfully interested in. I don't know how in the grand scheme of things, if that's a really great solution. We had, we're at the Natural Capital Project meeting last week, and there were venture capitalists there looking for things to invest in. And that was interesting. I've never been to an academic meeting where that happened. So green bonds seem to be something people are interested in, biodiversity offsets, but there's a whole, you know, variety. Even from like conservation easements, they're like, what is that? Oh yeah, well, we know about that around here. So.
Is there a plan rollout to whoever allocates money? You said the finance department's involved, but they're not the ones allocating money. Some Congress of some sort in each country, right? Who has the purse strings? Is there a plan to roll out the finance plan to that and whoever makes those calls?
Yeah, typically those are, counterpoints are involved in the formation of the plan. So we'll have somebody from finance, environment, planning, and then NGOs who may be the implementers, it depends on the country. And then usually there's somebody from the executive branch, whatever that is, to kind of, well, put up red flags, really. And think, okay, this is not going to work. This won't fly. And so, yeah.
Have you witnessed any of that?
I haven't. The two, South Africa and Philippines, are the two that have finance plans that are well along, and I don't support either of those directly, so I haven't been in the room when that's happened. I can see how it's going to probably happen in Indonesia, though. It'll be interesting. Yeah. Unless they have another election before we get stuff going, and then we get to start over again. Yeah.
Your time for one more?
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Seidl, for his time.